book of Hebrew, chapter 11, verse 1, the Bible simply says that now faith is the substance of things hoped for, the evidence of things not seen. So in essence, what we can say faith is simply believing in things you cannot see, believing in the invisible, the things that aren't tangible to your sight. That's what faith is. The Bible also says we walk by faith and not by sight. So the Bible is a book of faith. The Bible is a book of beliefs, belief systems. And you must have faith and belief in the word that a virgin had a baby. Huh? I got to believe that. Got to walk by that. You got to believe that Moses lifted up a staff and God opened up an entire ocean. I got to believe that because I've never seen that. A man was raised from the dead after being dead for all these days. Jesus said, come forth, and I got to believe that. So in believing and understanding who Jesus is and who God is, faith is the epitome of what our whole lives is all about. We must have faith. We must believe. We walk in it. That's what faith really is. Faith is simply believing in what I can't see.
It's just that it comes about in the historicity of things, being from the South. Our church is formulated based on blackness, and Baptist was white. And so that's where you get the term First Baptist, which was mostly the white churches, and a Second Baptist, which would be a black church. But I believe some of our forefathers began to go with the missionary Baptist. At least that's how some of the stories get to me. And so down through the years, when I just happen to be missionary Baptist in most of my hometown.
What God has shown me, He broke the Bible down for me into four parts. He broke the Bible down to me from Genesis to Malachi is our history. It's our origin. It's where we come from. If you don't know where you're coming from, how in the world will you know where you're going? So Genesis to Malachi is our origination books. It's the standard of God. God shows in His Old Testament from Genesis to Malachi His standard of living, and it's a high standard. But what it also shows is that we couldn't live up to that standard. So this is where the Gospels come in. So you got Genesis to Malachi, which is the first part. The next part is Matthew to John, Matthew, Mark, Luke, and John, the Gospels, which is the message. We got the history, and now we got the message. The message is the kingdom of heaven. The Lord came, and John the Baptist came before Him, and John the Baptist spoke. He says, you must repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. Jesus come. He gets baptized by John the Baptist, and all of a sudden, Jesus is preaching His first message, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. And then Jesus tells His disciples, you know, you guys go out, and I need you to go out and share, repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand. So the Bible is broken up from our history, then it's broken up to the message, which is the Gospels, and then from Acts to Jude is conduct, how to act in the kingdom, and Revelation is foresight and foreknowledge that which is to come. So God broke the Bible up into four places for me, and it's good for me to look at it in that aspect because I see it in its truth. If you take the Gospels, or the actual message, which is to repent, for the kingdom of heaven is at hand, the kingdom, the kingdom, the kingdom. Understand, we preach Jesus a lot, but the message, Jesus never preached Jesus. Only thing Jesus said about Himself was, I am the door. I am the way, the truth, and the life. No one gets to my Father except through me. Jesus said, if you want to get to the kingdom, you got to come through me. That's all He said about Himself. But we preach Jesus, preach Jesus, preach Jesus, preach Jesus. But the message is the kingdom. And the way to the kingdom is the door, and Jesus is the door.
You know, everyone seems, especially in this day of tolerance and acceptance, have bought into the lie that a choice, you know, that's negative and inconsequential to man is what? A right. And surely, you have the right to go in a store and steal, but it's against what? The rules of man. You may exercise your freedom. I mean, and what? Say, if I don't get caught, that's me. I stole it. And somebody says, all sin can be, any choice To legislate a choice and make it a right, we know that man is man and woman is woman. No one ever went to a doctor when they had a baby and asked them, and when they say, what is it? Is it a boy or a girl? You always look for the definitive because that's the way we are. But for us to be in a time in mankind where we are sitting around saying we accept that practice, and then we say it's a right, for it's a civil right. No, I'm born black. And so they're going to say they were born homosexual. And that's what they're going to say. And so, I say that the thief is born a thief. I say the murderer is born a murderer, but he's not allowed to what? Practice and exercise that because he can choose something different. But I can't choose not to be black. I can't choose how you treat me. You know, if you're treating me unethically, and we know that we have a law on the land that say we all should be treated a certain way, that's different. But, I mean, to sit up and tell me that I need to accept a person who's doing something that, I mean, and don't get me wrong, I'm not mad at any homosexual. Because, like I say, God hates the sin and not the sinner. But it's the sinner who's going to go to hell for the sin. That's what they miss. So that does not give me license to live in that way. Because if Jesus says, for it was not, from the beginning, it was not that way. For what? God created them male and female. And whenever I see a man carry a baby, then I'll know that something really was born different. But I have not yet seen that. And whenever I see two women have a baby without one of the women going and getting with a man or going to a sperm bank, then I'll know that God has what? Truly, they have been born that way. But until then, all they have is they're speaking it out their mouth to validate what they want to believe in their own heart.
What is the kingdom? First of all, we must look at the book of Genesis where God says, let us create man in our image. And in creating man in his image, I believe it's Genesis 1 and 26, he gave man dominion over the fowl of the air, the creepy things, the cattle. He gave man dominion over this planet, over this earth. So the word kingdom in Greek is translated king. Dominion is translated kingdom. So kingdom is the king's domain, the territory that the king rules. So no king can be a king without a kingdom. So with that in mind, you must understand that the kingdom itself is the territory that the king rules. That's all the kingdom is, the territory that the king rules. Most wars that have been fought in our history was over land, over dirt. Most kings went to war to increase their land. The more land a king had, the greater king he was perceived to be. So the kings went to war. That's why Alexander the Great tried to conquer the known world so that he would be known as the greatest leader there ever was on this planet. Napoleon, all these people were in war for land. Even today, 2015, we have wars and it's still about land. They may try to perceive it to be something different, but it's about land. It's about something in that land or the land itself. So with that being said, that's all a kingdom is the king's domain. And if it's over, if the wars are over land, we are still yet in a war right now. Why do you say that? Because we're in a spiritual war. We're in a war where there's God and Satan warring. Satan is trying to take away from God the land. What land does God have? Well, God created man from the dust of the ground, which means you, me, us, we are walking dirt. We're walking land. And the war is still over the land. It's still over us as souls. And Satan rose up and said, I will build my kingdom over yours. I will build mine over yours. So all he's trying to do is gather as much land as he can to build it over God. So that war is still yet going. The kingdoms are at war right now spiritually. And God's really not at war, to be honest, but Satan is at war trying to take away from God all the land that he can take to build his kingdom over his. So that's pretty much what a kingdom is.
The kingdom is a territory ruled by a king who's not present in that territory. A kingdom is a representation or a colony outpost of their home government, a hometown, or a home place. And that kingdom takes its orders from headquarters. That kingdom benefits its medical plan, its economic plan, okay, its laws, its army, all comes from the kingdom from which this kingdom exists. So we are part of the kingdom of God sent to this planet to occupy in the name of the King, to make earth look like heaven, so that people who come in contact with us touch heaven without actually going, because we represent heaven. Let's see, Chinatown, Koreatown, Jewish town. You walk into these neighborhoods, you experience the culture, the language, the smell, the color of where they come from, and you have experienced China without being in China. That is kingdom.
Because most people look at the church as a membership, as to like what do you call those thing where they go play golf?
Country club.
A country club, yeah. And when you pay your dues or your fees at a country club, when you get in there, then they wait on you hand and foot. They take care of you. You get special privileges, and you get this and you get that because you paid your dues, and you're entitled to this. You know, but church isn't like that. We're not a membership, because the Bible refers to our body as one body, but many members. My extremities are members of this body. And that's how we look at it. But that's not true, because though we're many members, I can be dismembered. I can be cut into pieces and all my members are gone. It's just the torso. But if I'm a kingdom citizen, I can never be dis-citizenshipped. That's not even a word. So looking at it from a citizenship versus a membership is different. When I come into the church, I might give my tithes and offerings, but I shouldn't expect special treatment, because when I come through that door, I should come through as a servant and not looking to be served. And most come, I've given and I need to be served. I need my needs taken care of. I need this. I need that. That's one of the biggest things I hear, is what I need. Everybody needs this. I need this. No one ever asked Bishop what he needs. But everybody tell me what they need, and I try to help here and try to help them. There's only so much you can do. Even if they just need prayer, well, I'm praying for you for your need, for your need. But are you praying for me for my need? Are you praying for the need of this church? Or do you even care? So if the door is closed today, those members that was going to that country club will find another country club to go to. So, but what about my country club? That's why I don't look at it as a country club. It's a kingdom. So I'm a kingdom citizen. I'm not a member. Make any sense?
Okay, we know Malachi said, well, prove me, and I will open up the windows of heaven. He said, will a man rob God? And then he said, it's cursed. But we know Jesus died on the cross to do what? To break the curses of man. I believe that one who doesn't, Paul said in First Corinthians 9, I believe, 60, I believe it is, I'm hoping, that you sow a little, you're going to reap a little. You sow much, you will reap abundantly. And so we understand that there is a principle in sowing. It's like the seed, a man having a sack of seed, and he goes on and gets one cup and throws it in a 50-acre field. And then he looks for the field to grow what? Abundantly, but he only put what? A little in. And so a lot of times, and I believe especially when it comes to a lot of our people when we're struggling, because the enemy has already impoverished a lot of us. By what? He give us these credit cards, and we get in debt before we even get good and saved. Then once we come and get saved, we fully in debt. And then we are struggling now, what? trying to get out of debt. And so, but the principle of tithing is a principle that works. You'd be surprised. The people that don't even probably believe in God, they're givers. They're givers. And they're going to give abundantly. And I believe that principle that God has put in there is just spiritual. It applies to everything a person. And so you take the Trumps of the world or the Bill Gates or Oprah Winfrey, they're going to keep getting because they give more and more. And because. And they don't even. They don't believe in your God. Not in that sense. They almost think they are God. But that principle that God has given, put on giving. He said, prove me. And see if I won't open up the... And he said, prove me, but just by what? Bring it into the church. There's no reason why we won't bring it into the church when these people will give to every other philanthropic area, arena that they can think of. And here we are. We serve a true and a living God. And we won't see our church flourish because we sit around and we want to give $1. And so, and then we wonder why we go through, in Haggai, he says, I'll blow on your money. And we wonder why so many of us go through struggles financially, because we try to hoard something, and God said, because we are stuck up pipe, what you have to do with it, you got to roll the root of it. So he has to root it out of our hands. Maybe it's a messed up car. Maybe it's a bad plumbing. Just when you thought you was about to. Holes in your pocket. Just when you thought you had something, then something came and took it. You know, you may thank God you had it, right? But there are plenty of people, though, who don't believe in God that believe in the principle of giving. And I believe that we do. You say sin. The real question that you say ask me, was it sin? I believe it's coming short, so it's a sin. But Paul's put it differently and said we're just going to reap little. If we're going to reap according to what we put in. So I'm hurting me, that's for sure, if I don't give. And I believe that, you know, even with your little, even if you're coming out of the world with all these bills, try to find a way to give to God. And I guarantee you the bills get paid. God blesses the 90 if you give him the 10.
DBR, its initials actually are an acronym for the death, the burial, and the resurrection. It's the death of Christ, the burial of Christ, and the resurrection of Christ, which is the foundation of our Christianity. You know, you got all these denominations running around the planet, and everybody's this and everybody's that, and this one is this of Christ, this one is that of Christ, and blah, blah, blah. But the foundation of all Christians is the death, the burial, and the resurrection. I don't care what you believe over here about Christ, what you believe. Do you believe he died? Yes. Do you believe he was buried? Yes. Do you believe he resurrected on that third day? Yes. Then you and me, we brothers or we sisters. That's the bottom line. You can talk high. You can talk about this. You can say baptized in this. You can say baptized in that. But the bottom line is we're Christians because we have the same foundational belief that Jesus was born, that he died, he was buried, and he resurrected. That's the bottom line. And once we get there, everything else is extra. That foundation is there. We need to build off the foundation. If I know you're a Christian, then you're my brother. I don't matter what you saying over here and I'm saying over there. We're brothers. We can disagree. That's fine. We can agree to disagree. That's fine. But the love must remain in the disagreement. That's the problem we have as a body. When we have a disagreement, the love vanishes. I can't stand you. I'm going to go over here and open up my own church and make it, you know, the church who believes what you don't believe, and we're going to start our thing over here. And a lot of this time, the person that does that is not even ready to be a pastor. But they had a disagreement with the pastor, or they don't believe what the pastor direction is going, so forget you, I'm going to go and start my own church. And that's why we got all these different churches running around here. And most folks aren't even pastors. They're leaders, but they're not pastors. And that's a whole other message, but, you know, that's what the DBR, the death, the burial, and the resurrection really is.
I don't feel nothing about Halloween. I don't celebrate it. I do not celebrate it. I know they come up with all kinds of things and announce All Saints Day and all that. Everybody's doing a junk in the trunk and every kind of facet to kind of take something that when I grew up as a little boy, I asked my mother, well, why were we serving the devil, worshiping the devils, and dressing up like ghosts and ghosts and goblins, and evil spirits and stuff like that. And that's what it was about. I said, so no, I don't celebrate, nor do I try to even make an excuse in order to keep the tradition. Just come up with some kind of very slick and sly way of trying to keep on continuing. No, we don't celebrate it. It's not a day. It's whatever. They want to kill the black cats and all that. Let them go out there and do their thing. That's their day. We have our own days. We have enough. And our days are not that strong because why? We don't know exactly when Jesus was born as we celebrate the Christmas season, but we do know he was born. So I have no problem with that. We do celebrate our resurrection. That's our greatest days, the birth and the death and his dying.
Because of the heart of the people, the lack of giving, you teach it, you preach it, you share it, you even live it. I live it before the people. And when you don't have much, and that's the actual demographic or the crowd that God has put in my stead, those that may not have as much as others, once you don't have much, you keep your hand closed tighter, you know, instead of opening freely. If you have a lot, then you can give freely because you don't feel it. So the scripture that talks about the lady that had the mite, it was saying how a lot of rulers or leaders gave much, but she gave all she had. She gave a little mite, and when she gave, which is like a half a penny, that's all she had. And when she gave it, God says she gave more than they. And they gave thousands and thousands, hundreds of thousands, but she gave more. Now, naturally and monetarily, they gave more. So what he's referring to is spiritually, she gave more. So in this tangible world, when it's all said and done and it's gone, all them hundreds of thousands that they gave, what did it do for them eternally? Nothing. But for her, much. So when the Bible says, he who was last will be first, this is what he's referring to. A lot of people believe that, you know, if I don't have much, I can't give much. Well, you're showing your lack of trust in God. You have to believe and trust in God. Your sacrifice of giving, God blesses that. And the body of Christ has lost sight of that. We don't give. The church just don't give like they used to. They don't sacrifice like they used to. They just won't move in that direction. And that's the bottom line. They hold. They clench. They keep. They're struggling and they're fighting, not knowing that the relief from their struggle is in their giving. They think they got to hold on to this. I've learned that if I don't have enough to pay the bill, then it must be a seed to sow, to grow, so that I can have much more to handle what I need. So in knowing that, planting seeds has always, and I believe always will, yield a harvest for me to do bigger and greater things in life. People are lacking it.
I don't believe in generational curses. This is a very interesting term that people have come up with, okay? But when you accept Christ, you're no longer under his curse, under the curse of the law or the curse of sin.
It's one on one,
okay? So what I think there are generational problems that happen because of the environment that a person is raised in. It, you know, you've seen it where there's five generations of single welfare mothers. But as far as God cursing a person's, no, I think people can bring curses upon themselves. But spiritually, when he washes you, Jack, you're cleansed from all unrighteousness.
The past, present.
Everything. This is the blood of Jesus Christ that cleanses you. So let's say you were brought up in a family, or fifth family, welfare mother. And there's certain things that you have inherited by reason of what you have learned in your life. Let me tell you something. God's word can give you the ability, because he separated you from that spiritually. You're not part of that. If there's certain things that have attached themselves to you in terms of how you see and process personally. When God saves you, he cuts off all that stuff. And then he gives you his word to be able to give you the tools that you need in order to walk in the freedom that comes, the liberty that comes from his word. You think about this. Those of us who are from African-American backgrounds, to a certain extent, until God breaks it, we carry certain vestiges from the slavery days. We were illegitimate. Come on. Maybe our parents got married five generations ago, but you go back far enough that you ain't going to find no marriage certificate. You ain't going to find no broom. You ain't going to find people. It's a whole different thing, right? You didn't really have a name. Your name that you had was taken on from the slave master. The name that you had and all that was taken away in Africa. When I got saved, I was made legitimate. I have a father, great grandfather. I know my parents, my great grandfather, five or six generations. But I got my lineage spiritually when I became a son of God. I'm adopted. I got a brand new name. I'm adopted into his family. I'm grafted in, and I can now apply and apprehend all the things that come from my father. No matter what my daddy Cyril did, just because he got a bunch of kids, had a bunch of kids and all that kind of stuff outside, has nothing to do with me. I've got a new name. I've got a new lineage. Identity. I've got a new identity. And the greatest is called child of God. Okay? So how would a generational curse fall into that? Right. When God said, I've been part of a chosen generation. This is from 1 Peter. A royal priesthood. I've been adopted. So how would generational curses apply? I don't see anything in the scripture that says that. But it sounds nice. What it really is, it's an excuse that people use to justify the foolishness that's still going on in their life. Look, you might have had a generational curse, but you can put your pants on now. You can keep your pants on. It's not about generational curses. You can decide you're not going to sleep with these guys. That has nothing to do generationally. If you embrace the generation that you are as a chosen generation, a royal priestess, whose name is daughter of God, you really embrace that, all that other foolishness drops right off of you. But if you tell yourself, well, I can't change my habits, you know, because I'm functioning under a generational curse, you're saying something about the blood of Christ that doesn't cleanse you from all unrighteousness, just a couple of things. And to me, no. When he said it's finished, he meant the whole thing.